detecting a massive object emerging from hyperspace.
The conclusion to the Siege of Mandalore, and with it, the entirety of Star Wars The Clone Wars, finished on May the 4th, 2020, showing us finally the events that were really only teased in the Ahsoka novel and in Star Wars Rebels, the end of Season 2. And there's so much to go into that I'm not even gonna humor people who haven't seen it. We're going right into spoiler territory. We're starting right off with Episode 1.
Sorry, I didn't think to bring you a jetpack.
So many Easter eggs and so much to discuss. I love that the original Lucasfilm LTD kind of logo came up in the beginning. We have a very non-traditional intro to a Star Wars The Clone Wars episodes. We have the traditional movie score was shown in the beginning. And there was, obviously the music picked right back up whenever it was kind of the whole previously on Star Wars The Clone Wars. General Grievous, really everyone has their look more like they do in Episode 3. I know that's been present in the rest of the season, but in this one it really just feels like it's kind of it's shown more, especially with General Grievous, but we only see him for such a short amount of time. It's almost, I almost wish they hadn't put that bit in there, because, now I'm going to be wishing, well, what if like the last two seasons of Clone Wars had that? This episode tied in perfectly with Episode 3. I didn't know how they would do it per se. I figured that this would be pretty much how they do it, like they're talking about going to Mandalore and then boom, Coruscant is attacked and Anakin and Obi-Wan need to leave. But how it was handled was done really well. I like that Rex was finally promoted. That's something that if you've been watching The Clone Wars for as long as I think most of us, or at least I have, then you've been wondering for a while, why hasn't Rex been promoted to commander? Why has he been kept at the captain rank when he has gone above the call of duty so many times and proven himself, especially when he's like chummy with some of the commanders? I mean, he might call them sir, but you know that they're friends. I love the reunion of Anakin and Ahsoka. I love that she gets lightsabers and they're blue, which at first I didn't quite understand. How I've explained it is that Anakin rebuilt them, and since Anakin is a Jedi Guardian and more, a blue lightsaber crystal would choose him, so when he rebuilt the lightsabers, they would be blue. But I think, honestly, the reasoning behind it is the same reasoning why Luke's lightsaber was green, is because it would just look better in the scenes. For those of you who don't know, Luke's lightsaber in Episode 6 was originally blue. If you look at some of the earlier trailers, it was blue, but they changed it to green because it looked better with the backgrounds and the settings they were in. I think the same is true with Ahsoka. Looking at these episodes, it looks a lot better with blue than it would with her normal green lightsabers. There are a ton of visual and auditory clues that you can see throughout these four episodes. Specifically, one that I think a lot of people picked up on was in the very beginning of the Siege of Mandalore. The music is exactly the same as the beginning of Episode 3 with the Battle of Coruscant, which hints to the fact that the two occurred at the same time. A lot of Rebels characters that were thrown in here in this Episode 9, that is Gar Saxon, who is seen in the Son of Dathomir comic. We see Rook Cast, who is also in the comic. I don't believe she was in Star Wars Rebels, but, I'm sure y'all will correct me if I'm wrong. Ursa Wren, who is in Star Wars Rebels. It's so interesting to see these characters. We know where they're going to end up. And that honestly is a huge, some could call it a flaw of this arc, is that we aren't watching to figure out what happens. We already know. We're watching these episodes to figure out how it happened. And I think that's a huge portion of this episode that it does very well, is it makes it entertaining to figure out what happens in between. Because we know the beginning, we know the end. We know how all these events are going to play out because we've seen the ends of the stories of all these characters. Darth Maul is killed by Obi-Wan on Tatooine. Ahsoka Tano survives through the original trilogy. Gar Saxon is shot by Ursa Wren. Ursa Wren ends up giving the Darksaber to Bo-Katan. We've all seen how these stories play out, but we really wanted to know how it got that way. And this is a vital link that I think really did well, and I'm just super happy with how these episodes all turned out. And am I the only one who really likes Olmec's Mandalorian armor? Like, it just looks so cool. Obviously, I've seen the memes, he's the pay-to-play player on any game, but I still think that his armor looks super cool and it's very official looking, and I don't know. But this episode ended perfectly on an ideal cliffhanger. I certainly was waiting for there to be more. If there was a way that I could like watch it pirated right away, episode 10 that is, I would have absolutely done it without a second of hesitation. It could have been such awful quality. I just needed to know what happened. But I'm very glad that I didn't do that, because the next episode is certainly a showstopper.
We're all going to back! We're all going to back!
Episode 10 of Season 7 feels slightly different. And honestly, that's the case with every single episode in this arc, is that they feel very different from one another. Episode 10 felt like it was very, you know, ominous and, you know, hey, we know what's going to happen. Like, you know, Anakin's going to turn, the clones are going to betray the Jedi, though that wasn't fully known. And I actually love that Maul somewhat understood and knew. We know from back in season 4, whenever Maul learns about the Clone Wars, he is kind of disappointed. He's like, oh, so it began without me. He knew the plan to an extent the entire time. He just didn't know everything that Darth Maul or Darth Sidious had intended. And I love the part whenever he's just like, you know, talking with Ahsoka, like, the moment may already be upon us. That moment is Order 66. And then when he sees Rex and the clones come in and shoot the Mandalorians and go to protect Ahsoka, he says, not yet. I think a lot of people misunderstood that scene to think that he meant, no, our duel isn't going to happen yet. But I don't think he even intended that to happen originally. He meant not yet as in, oh, so the clones are still loyal to you. Everything is, you know, the plan hasn't been set in motion yet. But the actual duel between Ahsoka and Darth Maul is absolutely amazing. I absolutely love how Bo-Katan just immediately rushes forward. And one thing that, you know, just a side point that I really love about this episode, if there's one thing I've noticed about the Clone Wars and could certainly say it as a flaw, is that the good guys always have blue lasers. The bad guys always have red lasers. It doesn't matter. In season 5, episode 1, when the Weequay pirates are taken over by Maul, every pirate who is loyal to Hondo has blue lasers, and every pirate who is loyal to Maul has red lasers. Stuff like this just doesn't make sense, and I'm really happy that these episodes actually fix that. The clones obviously have blue lasers, but the Mandalorians do not have red and blue lasers, which they did in season 5. Whenever there was that small skirmish that when Obi-Wan escaped, they all in fact have yellow lasers, which is how it should be. Mandalorian guns have yellow lasers, and that, you know, just seeing Maul flick them to the side like they were nothing, you know, and I love the callback to season 5, you know, is that any way to treat your rightful ruler? But the duel itself is something just otherworldly. It feels cinematic because it's mocap. It's the first and only lightsaber duel in Star Wars The Clone Wars to feature motion capture with Ray Parks playing as Darth Maul again. They did the same thing they did with Solo. Ray Parks plays the body and Sam Witwer plays the voice. Exactly the same. I you know, and this duel, like, at first, I'll admit, I wasn't a huge fan of it, but the more I watched it, the more I loved it, and I feel like an idiot for not liking it, because it's so high stakes, and I love how it's interlaid with the battle with Rex versus Gar Saxon, and, you know, this entire episode is done tremendously well. Each episode seems to kind of up the last one, which I didn't think was possible after episode 9, but somehow, this one has done it.
You survived.
Episode 11 is certainly the episode that I think everyone was waiting for. And the music only continues to hint at these facts, regardless of what happens on in the episode. There's that almost that small... It almost seems like Hans Zimmer's ticking music in Interstellar when they're on the water planet. Like, time is passing, and we know that as time passes, it's only going to get worse. We're only bringing it closer. And of course, that heart-wrenching scene with Rex and Ahsoka, whenever they say, you're a good soldier, the Republic couldn't have asked for better soldiers. And I also love that line. You know, many people wish that the Clone Wars had never happened, but without it, we wouldn't exist. Which, you know, it just stings extra hard because we obviously know that the clones were made to destroy the Jedi, but it doesn't make that each soldier was still, like, a good man before the inhibitor chips went off, obviously corrupting them, and obviously Order 66. I love whenever we actually hear all the stuff going on in Episode 3. For those of you who don't notice, Hayden Christensen, his voice was there whenever he said he must live, it's not the Jedi way, but we actually hear Matt Lanter say, what have I done? So that is the last line that we actually hear of Anakin Skywalker throughout Star Wars The Clone Wars. I love that Darth Maul knew what was coming and could sense it as it happened. And whenever we actually see the Emperor as he is at that point, possibly, actually I don't recall, he wouldn't be the Emperor yet, but you get what I'm saying. But whenever he says execute Order 66 to Rex, and Rex doesn't even hesitate. I know that was a bit of confusion, because in Star Wars Rebels, Rex is very adamant about the fact that he did not betray his Jedi, that he removed his chip before, which obviously it looks like they're doing a bit of a, you know, like, I don't know. I'm to be completely honest, it threw me off entirely when he actually executed Order 66, which, don't get me wrong, it was heart-wrenching, and it was definitely a moment I was on the edge of my seat, but it still left me wondering why exactly he did it if he knew about it. I love that he told Ahsoka, like, find fives before his mind completely snapped over. That was a nice callback to Season 6, the first four episodes of Season 6. I absolutely love those episodes, and it's really nice to see that. There's a lot of callbacks in many ways. Obviously, we see Ahsoka's droid from Season 1, R7. I don't think we see her in Season... I don't think we see it in Seasons 2 through 6, though I could be wrong. I'm sure it's in some background shots or something, but seeing it again is really nice. There's obviously a droid Cheep. I'm not gonna lie, I really like this droid. It's like a Republic chopper from Rebels, and Dave Filoni actually comes back and does the voice, which is exactly the same as Chopper, but, you know, I like Cheep. What can I say? I think he's a cute little guy. There were some great Easter eggs to Rogue One. You know, I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. There's a lot of great stuff. I also love how Ahsoka went to Free Maul. And I love that whole interaction. Just about every interaction, though few they may be, between Maul and Ahsoka is absolutely great. You know, I love when he's just like, oh, Carity, give me a fighting chance. And she's just like, I'm not rooting for you. That was one of the funnier moments in the episode, but definitely it had a very serious overtone, and, you know, the same goes for this entire episode. When Rex finally has his chip out, and he reveals to Ahsoka, you know, this is the entire clone army, like, no one is safe, and then it just cuts, you know, we know that obviously the next episode is going to be a heart-wrencher, and we know that it's going to be super high stakes.
My brothers are willing to die and take you and me along with them.
I want to start off by saying that episode 12 is incredibly entertaining. However, it's very short. It's only 24 minutes long. And when we compare other finales that Dave Filoni has done, specifically with Rebels, the finales are usually 40 minutes long. So the fact that he made a 24-minute last episode in lieu of a 40-minute episode, it kind of hurts. I'm not going to lie. I looked at this episode and I watched it at midnight and I saw 24 minutes and got incredibly disappointed that this episode would be as short as it was to wrap up as much as it was. However, after watching it, I actually think that it did it. I think it could have benefited from like another 5-10 minutes just to kind of flesh out the details, maybe go into some of the events that happened afterwards. But despite the fact that it wrapped up incredibly quickly, I actually think that it did a fairly good job, even a great job. I mean, if you look at IMDb and you look at the episode ratings for these episodes, there not a single one is below 9.8. It's incredible, and I hope it stays that way indefinitely. Darth Maul showing his absolute power and ruthlessness and completely destroying the hyperdrive of the whatever Venator class Star Destroyer they're on. I thought at first it might be the Resolute, but I don't think it is. It is curious that Ahsoka's droid just happens to be on this ship, because I would think that hers would be on the Resolute, which is Anakin's flagship. However, obviously it was not, because Anakin took his ship to Coruscant. The fighting with the 501st and the 332nd and Jesse and whatever clones were on board was heartbreaking, especially seeing Jesse, someone who we've seen from being just, you know, another clone trooper, developing him through Season 2, and then obviously becoming an ARC trooper in this season. We knew that it was short-lived. You know, every time we see a clone do something great in the show, we always knew, like, you know, hey, Order 66 is going to come and wreck that all up. It doesn't really make it any less sad, and especially the ending, that Ahsoka wouldn't kill any of the clones despite the fact that they were going to kill her or try to. And I love that Rex is just like, you know, those are my brothers, and then he sheds a tear over it. And it hurt. It hurt, I won't lie. I also love that she buried every single one of them and put their helmet on top of their grave, and she left her lightsaber, which is a callback to the actual novel. And the ending is... not what I expected, but kind of what I wanted. I just didn't know if they would actually do it. Seeing Vader come down, I think it's very heavily implied that this takes place years later. And seeing Vader pick up her lightsaber, ignite it, and then keep it kind of shows that he still has a soft spot. Because, see, Obi-Wan, to Anakin and Vader, Obi-Wan betrayed Anakin. So he held little, you know, remorse whenever they were fighting. Ahsoka is the one person who, from his old life, that he still holds in high regard. You can tell in the finale of Season 2 of Star Wars Rebels that he actually doesn't want to fight Ahsoka, which is something that, a courtesy he never showed to anyone else that he came into contact with. And we have the owl flying overhead, a reference to the sister or the daughter, whichever one she's called from the Mortis arc, who gave her life for Ahsoka's. The same thing can also be seen in the aftermath of her duel with Vader in Star Wars Rebels. The owl is there. The owl is also in The World Between Worlds in season 4 of Star Wars Rebels. It follows her around in pivotal and very key moments. And with that, Star Wars The Clone Wars is done. These 4 episodes are among the best episodes that I have ever seen for Star Wars The Clone Wars. It makes the rest of the show look like garbage, and I mean that in the most positive way possible. The quality in both animation, voice acting, sound, everything, lightsaber duels, is so far above that which we have seen presently in Star Wars The Clone Wars, even with just this season, that it blows it away. It obviously makes the Martez sisters arc look like a hot pile of garbage, even though we already thought it was whenever that came out. But if anything proves that this is the case, you know, these 4 episodes are. I hope that Lucasfilm Animation continues to make shows with this high caliber of animation and love as Dave Filoni has poured into this. I also love, for those of you who don't know, Dave Filoni actually consulted George Lucas because the two made the show together. So to have the last season not be include George Lucas is a little bit sacrilege, and I'm very happy that Dave Filoni actually acknowledges that rather than just say, well, he's not a part of the company anymore, so I can't consult him. And George Lucas actually loved what was done. He's, you know, based on conversations and what's been released from Dave Filoni. And you know what? I'm incredibly happy with this. I'm sad that it's gone. I'm sad that we didn't see as many episodes as we were originally going to see, but I am incredibly happy with what we actually got. What do you guys think? What was your reaction to these episodes? Was it negative? Was it positive? Are you happy that these episodes ended up the way they were, or do you wish that we could have seen more and had longer? Leave your comments below. Thanks for watching, and as always, I'll see you again next time.